Good morning, Sun Prairie. And we are so glad that you're joining us here today. If you are new to our church, thank you so much for visiting. And man, we hope that you make this your church home. We'd love to meet you. Come talk with Pastor Mark and I after service. We'd love to get to know you a little better. Today after worship, the 55 and plus group, Antiquities, will meet at Hofer's for a farewell for Dave and Rita Goff. So if you're in that group, let's send them off well. Get signed up for the 24 hours of prayer for the nations, prayer day that we're having in the coming week. This is this Friday and Saturday. So go to our website, click on the link, and find a slot. There's a particular people group that you're interested in, you want to pray for. This is a great opportunity to learn more about what's going on there and to pray for them. So I encourage you, get signed up on that link. The high school youth group will meet next Sunday after church to do our amazing race activity. So if you're a high schooler who would like to compete in the amazing race, come talk to me, send me a text, or we'll put a sign-up sheet on my office wall. I haven't done that yet. But get signed up, bring a friend. This is a great way for you to introduce friends to our church, and then bring them for a fun thing afterward. Finally, we encourage you to consider attending the 2024 Converge Heartland Cultivate Conference. That's September 26th and 27th. It really is such a sweet time of all of our churches. They come together and they worship. They talk about the great things God has done in our conference over the last year. And then we get to hear from some incredible speakers. So yeah, if you're interested in that, please let us know and we'd love to get you signed up for that. Alrighty. Psalm 86 is our passage today. I invite you to stand as we read God's word here. Prayer of David. Incline your ear and answer me. Preserve my life, for I am godly. For I am poor and needy. Preserve my life, for I am godly. Save your servant who trusts in you. You are my God. Be gracious to me, O Lord, for to you do I cry all the day. Gladden the soul of your servant, for to you, O Lord, do I lift up my soul. For you, O Lord, are good and forgiving, abounding in steadfast love to all who call upon you. Give ear, O Lord, to my prayer. Listen to my plea for grace. In the day of my trouble, I call upon you, for you answer me. There is none like you among the gods, O Lord, nor are there any works like yours. All the nations you have made shall come and worship before you, O Lord, and shall glorify your name. For you are great and do wondrous things. You alone are God. Teach me your ways, O Lord, that I may walk in your truth. Unite my heart to fear your name. I give thanks to you, O Lord, my God, with my whole heart, and I will glorify your name forever. For great is your steadfast love toward me. You have delivered my soul from the depths of Sheol. O God, insolent men have risen up against me. A band of ruthless men seeks my life, and they do not set you before them. But you, O Lord, are a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. Turn to me and be gracious to me. Give your strength to your servant and save the son of your maidservant. Show me a sign of your favor, that those who hate me may see and be put to shame, because you, Lord, have helped me and comforted me.
What an amazing God we just read about there. What an amazing God. Wednesday night. Anyone watch the live stream Wednesday night? I hope you heard our high school students and middle school students just belting it out. Let's hear you today as well. Oh God, we pray this morning that you would open our eyes and our ears and our hearts to receive what you have for us. I want to see you.
prayer today, God, that you would come and just be present with us. We trust your promise. We claim your promise that wherever two or three are gathered in your name, you are there. And Lord, we need you. We need you to move on our hearts in a fresh way today, Lord. Revive us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Your name today. As we just sang in the songs, Lord, you are holy. You're holy, you're holy. It means you're separate from us, Lord. You're exalted above us. So, Lord, we come to you with our needs. We are lowly creatures who need help. We need guidance. We need provision. And, Lord, we're so grateful that you are a God who needs no provision, who needs no help, because out of your fullness, you're able to help us. And so, Lord, we bring our prayers to you today, knowing that you're holy. Lord, there's a lot of tumultuous things going on in the world right now, between elections, between wars and rumors of wars, between all sorts of different things, Lord. We need you. We need your protection. We need your guidance. And so, Lord, we ask that you would give our leaders clarity, that you would give them godliness to lead and wisdom in those situations. Lord, we pray that you would turn our leaders' eyes towards you, that they would see that you are worth following, even in the minuscule areas of their life to the massive areas of leadership. We just pray that you would bring that. Lord, that your will would be done on this earth and that we would glorify you because of it. Lord, I want to lift up the needs of those who are sick or recovering. God, what we experience as years of suffering and intense pain or uncomfortability, Lord, all over on that spectrum of pain, you call in your word a light momentary affliction in comparison to eternity. And so, Lord, I pray that you would give us your view of that, that you would give us an ability to see how you utilize our hard circumstances to bring you praise. Lord, you use difficult moments to draw us near to you, that you might meet our needs, that we might worship you, that we might see you are sufficient, Lord. Lord, every moment we don't curse your name, every moment we praise you, it's storing up for us treasures in heaven that you say aren't even worth comparing, not even worth comparing to the pain that we're facing now. So Lord, for those who are experiencing sickness and difficulties in these areas, we pray that you would heal them, that you would give them deliverance. Lord, that they would experience healing. But Lord, we trust that even if that doesn't happen, you are good and that you intend good for us. That for those who know you, it's working for our good and for your glory. Lord, we lift up our military. As we just said and prayed to you in the midst of a tumultuous world, it can be especially scary for loved ones that we know and that from our very church that have gone into those hard places. We pray that you would protect them, that you'd give their commanding officers wisdom in the situations, that you'd give just the military members themselves integrity on the field, that you would help them walk in a way that's pleasing to you, and Lord, that you would deliver them from the hands of their enemies. Lord, protect our soldiers. And Lord, we pray for our missionaries. As we're focusing on missionaries this week within our denomination at large, as we focus specifically on praying for them, we pray that you would do mighty works in their ministries, that your name would be known among the nations, and that you would use people like us, use prayers from us, use funds sent from us to make your name known amongst them. Thank you that we get to partake and participate in your global work, Lord. And pray for those who are serving domestically as well, that you would give them fruitfulness in their labors, that they would see people come to know you, that your name would be made known here in the States as well. We love you, Lord, and in your name we pray, amen.
Last Sunday we celebrated our communion meal. We drank that cup representing the blood of Christ because we know by his blood we are saved. Oh, the blood cleanses the blood. Christ of lives demand. Shameful sin raised on him.
precious blood of the Lamb. What a sacrifice that saved my life. Yes, the blood is my victory. Oh, what love, no greater love. Grace, how can
we are so grateful for that promise that tells us that because of the shedding of the blood of Christ, our sins can be forgiven. We thank you. And Lord, we thank you that not only do you provide our salvation, you provide our daily needs. And we thank you, too, that you provided in abundance. And for many of us here today, it is a blessing. It is a pleasure. It is a joy to give. And so, Lord, guide us in our giving. Lord, may we see where you would have us to invest these gifts for your kingdom's glory. Amen. Well, preschoolers are dismissed to Children's Church. And if you would turn your Bibles, please, to 2 Samuel chapter 12. 2 Samuel chapter 12. Looks like a flowing river from up here. Yeah, beautiful. Let's pray. Lord God, thank you so much for your word. Thank you for the story of David. And although we don't have every single detail, Lord, we have a beautiful rising up of a great leader and then the failing of that leader. And today, Lord, we look at his restoration. And Lord, help us to see that you are a God who is all about restoring what is broken. Help us to see, Lord, that you can use even us. We who are broken, we who are sinners by nature, redeemed by the blood of Jesus, remind us today that you want to and you are able to restore. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, let's pick up where he left off last week. 2 Samuel 12, verse 13, David said to Nathan, after Nathan had confronted him about his sin with Bathsheba, David said to Nathan, I have sinned against the Lord. That's where we ended last week. And Nathan replied, the Lord has taken away your sin. You're not going to die, but because by doing this you have shown utter contempt for the Lord, the son born to you will die. So David confesses his sin to Nathan, the prophet, to God, his father, the sin of murder, the sin of adultery or rape, whatever you would call it. And Nathan says to him, you're not going to die, but your son will. Not only that, he has told David that the sword will not depart from your house, meaning there is going to be violence at home. And in later weeks, we will see how that plays out. That promise is fulfilled. And also, how David will be humiliated as his wives, his many wives, are taken advantage of by somebody close to him. But the first consequence of his sin is the death of the son born out of this adulterous affair. And I shared last week that this would have likely been an even greater agony for David to endure, the death of his son, than of his own death. And some of you are wondering, if God took that child, or if he died naturally. Because surely God wouldn't do such a thing. And I've had parents ask me that question when a child dies. Why did God take my child? And I will often respond, I don't believe God took your child from you as if he needs him more than you do, or needs her more than you do. But rather, God receives them. We know that the enemy is death. Death is part of what our enemy Satan uses to bring us down, to destroy. He destroys life. And so although I believe my response is often right, we see here, God did just that. Because we read in verse 15, after Nathan had gone home, the Lord struck the child. The Lord struck the child that Uriah's wife had borne to David, and he became ill. David pleaded with God for the child. He fasted, and he spent nights lying in sackcloth on the ground. The author of this text tells us that God did it. And I'm not going to debate that. I'm not going to, you know, say it was an anthropomorphic kind of thing. No. We're told God struck this child with illness. as God had revealed to the prophet Nathan, saying that you won't experience death, but your son will. This is the just penalty for a sin, the taking of a life. Life is required because of the curse of sin, all the way back to the Garden of Eden, right? What was the curse of Adam and Eve's sin? Death. And from that time on, you know, there was the whole sacrificial system, sacrificing an animal, the death of an animal, to temporarily cover over their sins. It didn't forgive their sins, temporarily covered over. It sounds crazy from a human perspective, but I want to remind you that God would in the future put forth a substitute to die as a just payment for your sins, his very own son. So that if we would believe that Jesus died and was and raised for our sins and confess him as Lord, we will be saved. And that is our great hope. Our great hope is that Jesus Christ became a substitute. He took our penalty. And by his death, our guilt was atoned for, paid for, the only begotten Son, Jesus. He was substituted, put in our place on that cross. So back to our text, David was a broken man in need of restoration. And the first step in David's restoration from this sin, from this low point in his, I would suggest the lowest point of his life, he needed to be restored. He needed to come back. The first thing that happened was God rocked his world. God rocked his world. And I want us to understand clearly that this was a just penalty imposed by God. The Old Testament law, I've talked about the sin against Bathsheba and Uriah. In the Old Testament law, that sin required death. That was the just penalty imposed in the law. And as we think about the sin of those who put their faith in Christ being paid for by God's own son, we're reminded that our sin is not overlooked. Our sin isn't overlooked. If we thought that, then Jesus' death wouldn't need it to happen. If God was just going to overlook our sin, no. Our sin was paid for by the blood of Jesus. The theological title we give this is his substitutionary atonement. His substitutionary atonement. Jesus is our substitute. But when David realized the consequences of this horrible sin, he was overwhelmed with grief. He was broken. He was in a shambles. This whole event rocked his world. And I think that for we who are believers, that's a place that we need to come to, or have come to. For those who are lost in sin, there's this place we need to come to, of brokenness over our sin against a holy God. I think about a time when a member of a former church was caught up in alcoholism. And the senior pastor of that church and his wife, his children, and work associates met him. His wife drove him to a place, and he thought they were going out to dinner. Well, it was a treatment facility. It's called an intervention. They deceived him and got him in this place, and they let him have it. They shared with him how his alcoholism was affecting his work. It was affecting his church, his life in church. It was affecting the life of his family. Had to intervene, and it rocked his world. As Christian or as lost people, we need to have that understanding of where our sin takes us, where it has taken us. It has placed us in a position of, as Paul says, enemies of God. We need that. We need to see that. And I think that's why that communion celebration we do once a month is so important to us, to remind us of this incredible, yeah, we talk about it as a gift, but it was an incredible tragedy, in a sense, that an innocent man was killed for us as our substitute. I think that's the place where we begin this restorative process of God, at the hand of God is when we recognize, when we realize how great our sin is. And I think that at the loss of his son, David got a glimpse of how great his sin was. He said, I have sinned against God. He was lamenting. He was lamenting that he had sinned against God. He was lamenting that his son's life was taken as just penalty. But he didn't continue in that lament very long. And we must not continue in our lament. I know people who live their entire lives groveling in shame because they've recognized, I'm a sinner. I am a loser. I am dirt. Even my best works are, as Isaiah says, as filthy rags. And we can't stay there. We can't stay there. David went through 7 days of anguish watching his son die for his sin. And in that time, he pleaded with God on behalf of his child. I wonder if it sounded similar to the pleading of our Savior Jesus in the garden as he prayed. If it's possible, please take this cup from me. Or if it's possible, God, take this cup from my son. I wonder if his prayer was something like that. We too must recognize and grieve over the just consequences of our sin that a totally righteous man, God's own son, the holy creator of the universe, died in our place. But we must not stay there. Instead, we must offer our gratitude and praise to the judge as well as the one who bailed us out and paid our debt. And we'll see that David did just that in these next verses. Verse 17, the elders of his household stood behind him to get him up from the ground, but he refused, and he would not eat any food with them. This is the time he's grieving as his son is dying. And in verse 18, on the seventh day, the child died. David's attendants were afraid to tell him that the child was dead, for they thought while the child was still living, he wouldn't listen to us when we spoke to him. How can we now tell him the child is dead? He may do something desperate. His friends were rightly concerned because something desperate, he might knock out the one who just brought the news to him that his son had died. Or worse yet, he might, because he recognized that it was because of his sin, he may have gone down the path of suicide. And that would just put the nation in shambles at this point. But as much as they were concerned about David's state of mind, they were equally surprised to his response or his reaction. Verse 19, David noticed that his attendants were whispering among themselves, and he realized the child was dead, and saying, is the child dead? Yes, they replied, he is dead. Then David got up from the ground after he had washed, put on lotions, and changed his clothes. He went into the house of the Lord and worshiped. Then he went to his own house, and at his request, they served him food, and he ate. He went to the house of the Lord, and he worshiped. What in the world? Can you imagine your son has just died, and the first thing you want to do is go to church? Here's the second step in David's restoration. He worshiped the Lord. If we want to be restored from death to life, we need to get to know the Lord in worship. We need to celebrate the Lord's work in worship. It becomes a part of this. Every Sunday, I believe that we have been restored and we are being restored, right? And every Sunday when we come to worship and we sing and we hear the word of God, and we are hopefully, prayerfully, I pray that we are moved to a point of repentance and a point of just, God, you are so good. You are so great. You are so awesome because of what you have done. That restores our soul. For we were beings created to worship. Amen? This is what we were created for. That's why it was such a blessing to me Wednesday night to be up here with a few other of our youth just leading in worship. And seeing the faces on those kids celebrating, hands raised, some of them, and just the beauty of watching God's youth worship. What did he worship God for? He had been told that this was a just sentence. He was content. His worship expressed his contentment with the wisdom of the Lord to do as he did. I believe that his worship expressed his contentment with what the Lord had done, how he had done it, dealing justly with his sin, bringing him freedom. If you think that David's response is unique, consider Job, what he went through. You remember the story of Job, the calamities that were a part of his life, and the first thing he did was to recognize the horror of his loss. We need to note that his loss wasn't a result of his sin. It was a test of faith. But what did he do? He tore his robe, he shaved his head, and then as we read in Job 1, 20 and 21, he worshiped the Lord. All of this horrible stuff. And what does he do? He worships the Lord. You know, we all react differently. And in my 40-some years of ministry, almost 40 years of ministry, I have watched people grieve. It is a privilege and an honor to do a funeral. It's really, really hard to be with people when they're grieving because everyone reacts differently to that grief. And we don't know what to do. We know to be there. I've found that reading scripture helps in those times. Praying with people helps in those times, but being there is often what some people need. For me, when my mother died not too long ago, this past year, I had to be here. The day after she died, I was here. I'd spent that morning with her, and she passed a little later in the day, and I had the privilege of coming into this place to be with you, because I knew I needed to be here. I needed to be here for myself because I knew that you would encourage me. I knew that you would lift me up, and you did. And what a blessing that was. What a blessing. I needed to worship God. And I didn't have to do that here, but I found great joy in doing it here. Now, maybe you can't be around people in the house of worship shortly after the death of a loved one. I get that. I think we all get that. It's just hard sometimes to be around people, especially large groups of people, when somebody close to you has died. But we must find a way. In the midst of that great loss and grief, we must find a way to worship the Lord, to give him thanks. Especially when a loved one is a believer. God, thank you. I praise you because you have taken this person, this one I love, and welcomed them into your presence. But what about if that non-believing relative, father, mother, sister, brother, what if they pass? What if they die and they did not know the Lord? How do you respond to that? Well, grieve, yes. Grieve your loss of them in your life. Grieve their loss that they will not experience heaven. But then give thanks to God. Give thanks to God that he had provided an opportunity for them to receive his grace. We must praise the Lord. The first step in being restored from the darkness of our sin is for God to rock our world. Secondly, we must worship the Lord. Verse 21, his attendants asked him, "Why are you acting this way? While the child was alive, you fasted and wept, but now that the child is dead, you get up and eat?" Because the cultural tradition was that they were to grieve for 7 days. And of course, that grief went beyond that oftentimes. 7 days they were to tear their clothes, cover themselves in ashen sackcloth. They would often hire professionals, mourners, to come in and mourn with them, to cry and to weep. But David didn't do that. Instead, when his son died, he got up, he cleaned up, and he lifted up the name of the Lord. Verse 22, he answered his attendants while the child was still alive. I fasted and wept. I thought, who knows, the Lord may be gracious to me and let the child live. But now that he is dead, why should I go on fasting? Can I bring him back again? I will go to him, but he will not return to me. David was simply looking at the child's death from a different perspective than everyone else. He realized, it's done. My child's life is done. My sin is done. Paying the penalty for my sin is done. I think he recognized here his forgiveness. I do. I'm going to digress here for just a brief moment and consider the theological implications of these last five words of David. I will go to him. I will go to him. Although it's not stated in our core beliefs, the historical teaching of Sun Prairie Baptist Church is that when children die lacking the mental or moral capacity to receive or reject Christ, not that they're innocent, but that God graciously applies to them an exemption from the penalty of sin. We call it different things, but we believe that when children die, they go to be with the Lord. And it's in part based on this image of saying, I will go to him to be with the Lord. Verse 24, then David comforted his wife Bathsheba, and he went to her and made love to her. David recognized, I'm not the only one grieving here. The woman who gave birth to his child, yeah, she was grieving as well. So here's a third step to this David's restoration, was that he went and he served others. David's sin had affected a lot of people. Imagine the disgrace in his household, his other children. Imagine the disgrace. Because people in town would have been talking, right? They would have been talking about this woman who had this baby and her son or her husband was off to war. Some of them would have known he didn't go home those nights when he was home, when he was back in town. Think about the pain of Bathsheba as she wept over her son those last 7 days. And David comforted his wife. Don't know how he did this, but as king, he would have had all sorts of resources available to comfort his wife. Maybe some maidservants to go in and attend to her, to just be with her. Whatever the case, maybe it was he pulled out his harp. I imagine his harp somewhere in his big mansion, his palace there. I imagine he had that harp stowed away, and he's thinking. And he went and got his harp, started playing some music for his wife, as he used to do for Saul, King Saul. I don't know. We don't know. But it says he comforted his wife. When friends I know experience the loss of a loved one, I try to spend at least a little time with them. As I said, I read scripture. I pray with them. I pray for them, even when I'm not with them, that the Spirit of God, who is the God of all comfort, would come to them and comfort them. At some point, oftentimes, what I will do is I will encourage somebody to get back into whatever ministries they've backed away from for a time. At some point, I encourage them to serve others. In serving others, we are able to be a part of God's restoring us. For David, that was part of his recovery, if you will. Well, verse 25, she gave birth to a second son. They named him Solomon. The Lord loved him, and because the Lord loved him, he sent word through Nathan the prophet to name him Jedidiah. God is directly involved in the restoration of the house of David. We've been looking at what God did and what David did to move this restoration process along, and we see here God at work. He blesses David with another child. God blessed David. another son, an heir to the throne. They named him Solomon, but he was to be given the name Jedediah. You know, the name Solomon means beloved of the Lord. Or the name Solomon means peaceful. And the name Jedediah means beloved of the Lord. And I wonder, if you were given those two names, which one you would prefer? Beloved of the Lord, Jedediah. I mean, to me, that's better. I just think, wow. Peaceable, yeah, that's cool. But beloved of the Lord, what a great name, Jedediah. But this is the only place we see this name given for Solomon. Why didn't David and Bathsheba call him Jedediah? We don't know. Maybe they did it on special occasions. Maybe they just did it at home. I don't know. But in all the rest of Scripture, we see him, the biblical writers that God inspired, call him Solomon, not Jedediah. But here's the thing I really want us to see here. This marriage between David and Bathsheba, they got married. This marriage, born out of sin, was now affirmed by God. He had completely put away David's sin. David was forgiven. And the only thing that was left for David to do was to live as the king. Listen to the words of the genealogy of Christ recorded in Matthew's gospel. David was the father of Solomon by Uriah. So God used an heir of David born of a wife he had acquired through adultery and the murder of her husband. God would use that heir to continue the line of David all the way to Jesus. And there's other parts of that genealogy that just confound the mind that God would use such people in his line of bringing salvation to the world. This points to the incredible grace and mercy and power to transform that comes only from the Lord. In the New Testament, we have a beautiful example of this restoration in Peter, the one who denied Christ three times. Yet, and I imagine Peter after that third time just being crushed by his own sin and thinking, I can never be used of God again. Maybe you've been there. Maybe you've experienced sin in your life, committed sin in your life, where you think God will never want to use me. And I think of Peter, how much worse could it be? You say, I never knew Jesus. Nope. And you deny him. Yet, who is it that preaches on the day of Pentecost and thousands, one of the greatest revivals we've ever seen in history, it happens there, and he's the preacher. Peter's the preacher. Because God raised him up, God restored him, and God used him. We all love John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes will not perish but have everlasting life. But the next verse is a great reminder of what God doesn't focus on. It says he didn't come to condemn us. He came to save us. He did not come to condemn us. He came to save us. But I believe it's not just salvation from sin. Absolutely it's that. It's salvation to new life. It's salvation to a life in Christ. It's salvation to a life with meaning and purpose. Jesus saves, Jesus restores, Jesus transforms. The law condemns, but Jesus saves, Jesus restores, and Jesus transforms. And we see God using David to lead Israel. Verse 26, meanwhile, Joab fought against Rabbah of the Ammonites and captured the royal citadel. Joab then sent messengers to David saying, I have fought against Rabbah and taken its water supply. Now muster the rest of the troops and besiege the city and capture it. Otherwise, I will take the city and it will be named after me. So David mustered the entire army. David's going to war. A guy who was just broken and crushed. He's back to leading his nation again, leading in battle. He mustered the entire army and went to Rabbah and attacked and captured it. David took the crown from their king's head, and it was placed on his own head. It weighed a talent of gold. I don't know why these details are given. And it was set with precious stones. David took a great quantity of plunder from the city and brought out people who were there, consigning them to labor with saws and with iron picks and axes, and he made them work at brickmaking. David did this to all the Ammonite towns. Then he and his entire army returned to Jerusalem. So the final step in David's restoration was to get back on that throne. David, yeah, you've really failed, but you need to get back on that throne and you need to rule again. And that's what this description of him going off to battle, that's what he's doing. He's taking leadership again. He did not let the sin, because he realized it was forgiven now, he didn't let the sin hold him back from doing what he had been called to do, what he had been ordained to do. Got back on the throne. Crown on his head. All kinds of riches from the plunder. We would probably say he got back in the saddle. I'll never forget the day we had brought home a little miniature horse for our granddaughter. Because the big horses she was afraid of, she was really nervous. Oh, this little horse, it was perfect. I bought a little miniature saddle, put on it, set her on the horse, walked around in the arena that we used to have out there, and this little horse was just great. Walked her. That little horse out of that arena, and it went to bucking like crazy. Threw her up in the air, on her back, knocked the wind out of her. She was screaming, and I was the grandpa that really messed up. I picked her up, I coddled her, and you know what I did next? Put her back on the horse. Because I knew that to overcome that fear, she had to get back on. And I prayed, Lord, let this horse do its job right. Because I didn't want to forever destroy her confidence. But what that did, getting back on the saddle, it restored her confidence. And I believe that when David got back on the throne, when he started went back to leading the people of Israel, his confidence was restored so he could lead again in the way that Christ would have him to lead. Friends, if you've been broken by circumstances, whether you created or something else has happened to you, maybe somebody has abused you, if you have wrecked your life by your own sin, kind of a self-inflicted thing, get up. Get back in this thing we call life. Start doing life again. If you have any bitterness or any shame, allow God to heal you. Pray that God would heal you. Get up, get back in this thing we call life. God is in the business of restoring broken people. He heals the brokenhearted. He binds up their wounds. 1 Corinthians 1:27, Paul says, but God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. He chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. He chose what is low and despised in the world, even things that are not, to bring nothing to nothing, things that are. In Christ, it is in Christ that all of this is possible. Only when we surrender to Christ that anything good that comes out of our lives is possible. And so we sing. Worship team, will you come? Yet not I, but through Christ in me. Let's sing that song in closing. What gift of grace is Jesus my Redeemer. There is no more heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness, my freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. I pray that's a truth for you.
What gift of grace is Jesus my Redeemer? There is no hope for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love. To this I hold.
God, use us this week. Reveal your glory in us and through us. God, may you draw people to yourself and use us in that work of building your church, we pray. Amen.